यहीं से लॉकडाउन। गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट एनाफिलेक्सिस इन चिल्ड्रेन एंड व्हाई आई हैव सिलेक्टेड दिस टॉपिक। एनाफिलेक्सिस इन चिल्ड्रेन इज नॉट अनकॉमन एंड इन डे टू डे प्रैक्टिस मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम इट गोज अननोटिस्ड बिकॉज ऑफ द लो इंडेक्स ऑफ suspicion and the main reason why we do not suspect it in children is many features of anaphylaxis are usually seen in other diseases of infants and children. So this is very important topic and we should know about this. And according to the ICD classifications, anaphylaxis is defined as severe life-threatening systemic hypersensitivity reaction, which is characterized by rapid in onset. And it is potentially life-threatening airway, breathing or circulatory problems. So it is characterized by rapid in onset and potentially life-threatening airway, breathing or circulatory problems. Usually, although not always, it is associated with skin and mucosal changes, which is easily recognized. So, worldwide incidence of anaphylaxis in children varies from 1 to 761 per 100,000 persons years for total cases of anaphylaxis and 1 to 77 per 100,000 persons years for food-induced anaphylaxis. Epidemiology is hindered by difficulty in timely assessment of symptoms. So, there is difficulty in timely assessment of symptoms. So, epidemiology varies. In infant and children, it is very difficult to recognize as symptoms are similar as I have already told. And it is similar, the symptoms are similar to various diseases of infants and children, and high index of suspicion is required for diagnosis. So this is regarding worldwide incidence of anaphylaxis in children. What are the triggers of anaphylaxis in children? So most common trigger is the food allergen, and among food allergens, commonest are cow milk protein, egg, peanut, tree nut, and seafood. Next are medications, and next is hymenoptera toxins. And less common triggers are physical exercise, aeroallergens, that is airborne allergens like pollens. Contact with latex is very common in hospitals, and so many things are being manufactured with latex which are being used in children. And radio contrast media, when we request for CT scan or MRI in children, so for contrast enhancement, radio contrast is being used, and some children may develop anaphylaxis with this radio contrast media. So we keep ourselves prepared to face this anaphylaxis reaction if it will happen by arranging resuscitation equipments beforehand while we go for MRI or CT scan in children. And next is ethanol. It is found in various medicinal preparations in children, various syrups in children, and some children may be allergic to these and may develop anaphylaxis after ingesting these syrups. So what are the mechanisms of this anaphylaxis? Almost all anaphylactic reactions are IgE, immunoglobulin E mediated. Sometimes non-IgE mediated immunological mechanisms are there, and there may be direct mast cell activation, for example, by physical exercise. Sometimes anaphylaxis reactions may be idiopathic and cause is not known. So this is very dangerous when the cause is not known and there is anaphylactic, idiopathic anaphylactic reactions in children. So how to diagnose this anaphylaxis in children? Diagnosis is based mainly on clinical assessment, that is history and clinical examinations. And in clinical assessment, there may be exposure to allergen, and it is followed by rapid development of symptoms within minutes to hours. And investigations are required when the allergen is known. If we know the allergen particularly for that child, we can investigate for that allergen in that particular child. And the common symptoms are urticaria, swelling of oropharynx, rhinorrhea, cough, breathing difficulties, vomiting, progressive abdominal pain, pallor, irritability, and sleepiness. So these all symptoms, other than skin rashes, urticaria, or swelling of the oropharynx, may be seen in different diseases of infants and children. So it is very difficult to diagnose anaphylaxis in infants and children. This is the reason diagnostic criteria is available to us. And what are that diagnostic criteria by which we can diagnose most of the cases of anaphylactic reactions in children accurately? So the number one criterion is acute onset within minutes to hours with involvement of a skin, mucosal tissue, or both in the form of hives, pruritus, flushings, swollen lips, swollen tongues, swollen uvula, with at least one of the following, means among two, one of the following. Number one is these skin and mucosal signs could be associated either with dyspnea, wheeze, stridor, reduced peak expiratory flow if we can measure, and hypoxemia. This is the respiratory compromise. So this skin and mucosal involvement could be associated either with respiratory compromise or cardiovascular compromise. Respiratory compromise in the form of dyspnea, wheeze, stridor, reduced peak expiratory flow, if we can measure it, and hypoxemia, or reduced blood pressure, or associated symptoms of end organ failure in the form of hypotonia, collapse, syncope, and incontinence. So these are the features of compromised cardiovascular system. This is the number one criteria. Second, two or more of the following. So among A, B, C, D, 4, there should be presence of two. So A is involvement of skin and mucosal tissue, which I have already elaborated. What are the manifestations? B, respiratory compromise. I have already elaborated what are the features of respiratory compromise. And C is reduced blood pressure or associated symptoms of end organ failure. I have already mentioned. And last is persistent gastrointestinal symptoms like cramping, abdominal pain, and vomiting. So if two or more of these four are present, then it is anaphylaxis. And the third criteria is only cardiovascular compromise in the form of reduced blood pressure after exposure to a known allergen. And in this age-specific, low systolic blood pressure should be taken into account, or more than 50% decrease in systolic blood pressure is important. So how we can assess this low blood pressure? So in general, if we have chart, we can see it. In general, in infants, that is 1 month to 1 year of age, if the systolic blood pressure is less than 70 millimeter of mercury, after 1 year, 1 to 10 years of age in years, 70 plus 2 into age in years, but it comes if the systolic blood pressure is less than that, and after 10 years up to the age of 18 years, if the systolic blood pressure is less than 90, so millimeter of mercury. So if it is there, it means reduced blood pressure. Or if we know the baseline blood pressure of any child, and if it decreases by more than 30%, then it is reduced blood pressure and fulfilling the criteria of anaphylaxis in children. So time course of reactions may be uniphagic, biphagic, or protective. So in uniphagic, it occurs immediately after exposure and resolves within minutes to hours without treatment. And in biphagic, it occurs immediately after the exposure and resolves, but recurs usually after 8 hours of the resolution. And in protected phenomena, it persists for hours to days following initial reaction. So sometimes we can see a child suffering from anaphylaxis after 2 or 3 days of exposure also. So this is protected anaphylaxis. So what are the roles of laboratory test? Component resolved diagnostic tests identifies epitopes linked to severe anaphylactic reactions, and there are two common epitopes which can be measured. That one is arachis hypogea 2, in short ARAH2, and it is for peanuts. So peanuts are the common allergen for children, and second is lipid transfer proteins, and it is for fruits and vegetables. So we can measure it. Second is serum tryptase, and it is measured after 15 to 180 minutes after the exposure to Anoptera or drugs. So it is for tryptase is for Anoptera and drugs. It is not for foods, fruits and vegetables. It is not for food. And next is serum histamine. It is measured after 15 to 60 minutes of onset of symptoms, but it is not specific, neither very sensitive nor specific, because histamine is released in so many reactions other than anaphylaxis. So it is not specific, but it can guide us. And if the serum platelet activity factor are raised, so it indicates severe anaphylactic reaction. So how to manage a child with anaphylaxis? So management starts with assessment and maintenance of airway, breathing and circulation. Patient should be kept in recumbent or semi-recumbent position. This is a very, very simple step, but very, very important step. Why? Because it preserves fluid in central vascular compartment and prevents empty vena cava or empty ventricle syndrome. This is very, very important, because if you put the child suddenly in upright position while he is experiencing anaphylaxis, then there will be sudden development of this empty vena cava or empty ventricle syndromes. Blood will not go into ventricles, adrenaline will not work, and the child will die. No medicine is going to work. So sometimes you can see it when the child experiences anaphylactic reaction, severe anaphylaxis, and the child has attained upright positions and there has been sudden death. So this is a very simple but very, very important step in the management of anaphylaxis. So patient should receive adrenaline immediately. It is the medication of choice. Prompt injection of adrenaline has been associated with better outcome, and intramuscular route is optimal. No need to give intravenous. Sometimes intravenous access is very difficult in emergency, so don't waste time. The optimal route is intramuscular, and adrenaline, which is available in the market in concentration of 1 milligram per ml, and it should be used in the dose of 0.1 सॉरी दिस इज रॉन्ग, 0.01 मिलीग्राम पर के जी बॉडी वेट. सो हियर इट शुड बी 0.01 मिलीग्राम पर के जी बॉडी वेट एंड द मैक्सिमम सिंगल डोज इज 0.5 मिलीग्राम एंड इट कैन बी रिपीटेड एट एन इंटरवल ऑफ 5 to 10 to 15 मिनट्स टिल द कंडीशन स्टेबलाइजेस. अदर ट्रीटमेंट ऑप्शंस आर हाई फ्लो ऑक्सीजन एंड इट शुड बी गिवन इन पेशेंट्स विथ रेस्पिरेटरी सिम्टम्स और विथ शॉक. So if there are respiratory symptoms or the patient is experiencing shock, so high flow oxygen should be given for life saving and volume support with crystalloid or colloid expander should be given in cases of hypotension. So blood pressure measurement is very important in the management of anaphylaxis. So if there is hypotension, immediately give crystalloid or colloid depending on the situations. Role and efficacy of antihistamine and corticosteroids has not yet been clarified, although these are frequently administered. So sometimes it works, sometimes it may not work. So the mainstay of treatment of anaphylaxis is adrenaline. So what are the signs of severe anaphylaxis? So the following are the signs of severe anaphylaxis: sudden itching of eyes, nose, generalized pruritus, flushing, urticaria, angioedema, loss of bowel control. So loss of bowel control may be sign of severe anaphylaxis. Loss of bowel control is usually seen in children diarrhea, but here it may be the sign of severe anaphylaxis. Cyanosis, clinical cyanosis or saturation less than 92% or respiratory arrest. Hypotension and or collapse, dysrhythmia, severe bradycardia and or cardiac arrest and confusion or loss of consciousness. These are the signs of severe anaphylaxis. So be alert and promptly treat it, otherwise you can lose the child. So what are the long-term management? Patients with history of anaphylaxis should be referred to a specialized allergic clinic for identification of allergens by skin prick test, intradermal test, prick to prick with raw food. This is test being done in a specialized clinic with equipments available for resuscitation. Serum specific IgE for suspected allergen. This is in vitro test. Blood is drawn and serum IgE for a specific allergen is measured. Oral challenge test for food and drugs. And this is very dangerous oral challenge. You should be equipped with resuscitation equipments before doing this test, and it is this test, and it is being done in a specialized allergy clinic. And next is molecular diagnosis, which I have already described. What we see in molecular diagnosis, that is epitope. So, what are the indications of self-injectable adrenaline? So, these are the situations when the child is given a pre-filled EpiPen. EpiPen is the market name in which there is adrenaline. So these are the conditions in which a child should be prescribed self-injectable adrenaline in the form of EpiPen. And what are the conditions? Previous cardiovascular or respiratory reactions to food, insect sting or latex, exercise-induced anaphylaxis. So exercise-induced anaphylaxis may be of two types. One is exercise per se activates the mast cells. Second is food allergens after some exercise gets activated and cause anaphylaxis. So second is exercise induced anaphylaxis. Then idiopathic reaction, this is very dangerous, as I have told you. There is sudden onset and cause is unknown. And child with food allergy and asthma. Because the child is suffering from food allergy and asthma, then there may be severe bronchospasm leading to hypoxemia and respiratory arrest. So these are the situations in which a child should be prescribed self-injectable adrenaline in the form of EpiPen injection, which is available in market. So what is immunomodulation in the treatment of anaphylaxis? So it is available for venom, Hymenoptera venom, and it is successful in 95 to 100% cases. And in wasp, it is successful in 95 to 100% cases, and in bee, it is successful in 80% cases. desensitization protocols in antibiotics and NSAID. So sometimes there may be the child may be allergic to some antibiotics. In that case, at first, alternate antibiotic could be chosen. And if it is not possible to choose alternate antibiotic, then desensitization could be done before prescribing, before giving antibiotics. And another is non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs. Sometimes the child may be allergic to diclofenac, and the child may develop anaphylaxis. So in this situation also, desensitization is done because this is a common drug, and the child may require this drug in future also. And there are some desensitization available for some food allergens. So the take-home message is: anaphylaxis is life-threatening. High index of suspicion leads to diagnosis. Diagnosis is mainly clinical. Food allergens are the commonest cause, and mainstay of treatment is injectable adrenaline. Thank you very much. So you see this child, and by seeing only, you can suspect this child may be suffering from anaphylaxis due to any cause. Thank you very much. If you have any question regarding this, you can ask. What? Molecular epitopes. There are two epitopes available. Already I have told you. So epitopes are available for certain allergens. I am coming to this, see this. Arrakis hypogea 2 for peanuts, and lipid transfer proteins for fruits and vegetables. Any other question? No. We can give it intravenously. But there is sometimes problem to access the intravascular route. So it has been studied that intramuscular route also acts as in a similar way. So there is no difference between intramuscular or intravenous route. So it is easy to administer intramuscularly. So directly administer intramuscularly. Don't wait for intravascular access, because sometimes the child has been brought in the condition of collapse. You cannot find vein for intravenous access. So what will you do in that condition? Directly inject intramuscularly, and it will work in the same. That is the reason auto injections, that is self injectables, is being given to child, and the child cannot inject intravenously. So the child will inject intramuscularly very in a easy way, and it works. What? No. Efficacy, maybe there is difference in time of onset, but it has been studied that the intramuscular route is optimum when you inject in the anterolateral part of thigh. It has rich vascularity, so it is the optimum route you can give. Other question? Urticaria, you can see urticaria on the skin in the form of wheels. But in angioedema, there will be only swelling. There will be no wheel-like lesions in angioedema. There is swelling of the lips, swelling of the tongue, swelling of the jugula, swelling of the pharynx, swelling of the larynx. So these are the features of angioedema. If there is a ring-like lesions, hives, then it is urticaria. So urticaria may be isolated, only urticaria. There may be urticaria with features of angioedema. Yes, how to difference from anaphylaxis? So there are various conditions when the child is allergic, atopic to various things, and the child develops pruritus, itching, or these hives or the urticaria. So we cannot say it is anaphylaxis. So for anaphylaxis, these symptoms, these signs or symptoms could be associated with either respiratory compromise or cardiovascular compromise. Respiratory compromise in the form of wheezing, stridor, hypoxemia, reduced PEF. So this is the features of respiratory compromise. And in cardiovascular compromise, there may be hypotension, collapse, hypotonia, syncope. So in isolation, hives or pruritus, urticaria, it is not anaphylaxis. If these features are associated either with respiratory compromise or with cardiovascular compromise, then it comes under the diagnosis of anaphylaxis. Any other question? If there is no question, thank you very much.